my job is to come in and treat all of the artists that I work with like, you know, the way Da Vinci was looking at Mona Lisa.
Pharrell Williams, welcome to Talk Asia and to Hong Kong.
Thank you.
You've worked with so many, some of the best artists, musicians, singers out there right now. Some have described you as having this unique perspective, and that's why they want to work with you. What do you think it takes to bring out the best in someone, bring out their version of the best?
The more I can make a person comfortable in their environment by taking my ego's hat off and leaving it at the door, then they can dive deep within themselves and we can pull out something interesting that people have never heard before. It's the stuff that no one's ever heard before is really interesting. Those are the things that stick. But you got to get it right. And you learn as you work with people, the more comfortable they are, the more they'll give you their best. So when a person walks in the studio, I'm looking at three things. I'm looking at what they say they want. I'm looking at the energy that they bring in. And then the third thing is what I may find interesting with their voice. So what I try and do is I try and mix the textures. Like, okay, your voice sounds like this, and you come from this genre, but what if we mix a little bit of that? I find that it always works when you find the interesting friction, the interesting alchemy between two things, the juxtaposition. That to me makes for very interesting music.
What gave you the courage, though, to forge ahead with that kind of thinking?
I didn't have much, so I didn't have anything to lose.
There are those that would say the pressures of, say, an industry, a record company, that says, well, you know, we really want a number one hit. We want this kind of music because that's what apparently sells.
I would say don't sign to a record company that's talking to you like that. There are some really good record companies out there, and then there are some out there that, like, you know, they chart chase. And as much as we appreciate the charts, you know, what is the chart without the art, right? Like, you know, it's the music that people feel. I really honestly, I'm so happy to be involved at a time where music is honestly changing for the better.
Would you say you could divide your life into pre-Ralph Lauren silver jacket?
Where are you getting this from?
To where you are now. Well, I read that you worked very hard to try and save money for the silver Ralph Lauren polo jacket.
Yes, it's true.
And then the moment you got it.
Yes, the moment I got it, it was kind of like, okay, I see I can do something. Even though my manager at the time, he's still my brother, Rob Walker, used to joke me all the time about how obsessed I was with the foil style. You know, Ralph Lauren, it was double RL. It was RL 2000, which was a ski collection. And I don't know, man, you know, polo has always been a staple in my community. It's just something that, like, aspirational and, you know.
Didn't you save money by working at McDonald's? But you didn't do very well there. The irony of that story, though, Pharrell, is that you end up producing their most iconic jingle. I'm loving it.
I never thought about that. I never put the two together.
The irony.
Probably because I got fired all three times.
But the irony is, that song that everyone recognizes, you're responsible for, the Neptunes are responsible for.
Well, Chad and I were very thankful for that opportunity. And we also had to thank Steve Stout, who got us that opportunity. I am different. I am weird. You're right, I don't fit in your world. You want to know why? Because I'm other.
I am other.
Right.
Is that true that that was born out of a conversation with Lauryn Hill?
Yes.
That she wanted other from you?
Your research. Okay, you can tell I'm not used to these types of interviews. This is awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's an awesome experience. Yes, and no, I never got a chance to work with her, but that's what she said to me. She was like, you know, she was like, you know, brother, I like what you do. I like what you and Chad do. You know, you guys are the Neptunes. You have the Neptune sound. But, you know, I need other. And I was like, wow. She said she needed other. Mm-hmm. And that stuck with me. And so when it was time to sort of push the reset button for myself and, you know, for my working family, I just wanted to make a statement.
Tell me about your partnership with Chad Hugo. You both seem to have this love of music, not just the sounds of it, mm-hmm. but the physiology of music, mm-hmm. every single element mm-hmm. of it, whether it's the chords or the way it's put together, the construction of it.
I have no idea. I gotta say, the moment that it hit me that I needed to do music is I heard the first Tribe Called Quest album, and that just, like, I just didn't understand why it was so good. So we began trying to deconstruct these songs to figure out why it did that, and then, like, in figuring it out, it was like, okay, we have to do this. And so every day after school, we used to go to, Chad and I used to go to this this little gifted program called Old Donation, the Center for the Gifted and Talented. And every day after school, we would just, like, jam and learn. I don't want to be esoteric. We get inspired by, like, things we see or hear or things we encounter, experiences. But then there are moments when those things run out, when you have nothing else and you're tapped out. That is the best place you could ever be, because now the only thing you have is intuition. And for me, I can go in the shower or listen to running water or on a plane. Your imagination just wanders off. That's the gift. And in school, some of your teachers are talking, and it's like Charlie Brown's teacher, like, wah, 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 wah. That kid that's daydreaming, that's the next book or chair or building. That's where all the great stuff comes from. And that's the thing that I don't think that they teach our children that. I mean, I wasn't taught that. When my mind wandered off, it was like, okay, he's not paying attention. Dr. Ramachandran, the guy that you referenced earlier, he said the apes and the monkeys reach for fruit, but man reaches for stars. And that's the difference.
Yeah.
That's the difference. And everything that we joke about, that we say is crazy and totally impossible, we end up doing 10 years later. You know, like, the moon is a real thing. We've surpassed that.
What has been for you the closest to the stars and to the moon in terms of wanting to reach for something and grabbing it?
My family. It's awesome. I'm eternally grateful. You can always see me saying thanks.
Well, we thank you, and we're grateful to you for your time.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure.
Oh, my God. This is a great interview.
Thank you so much.
I never look at my interviews because I always look like a goofball.
You know.
But I have to say, like, I'm going to make sure, like, I'm going to make sure everyone watches this one. I got something wrong. I got something wrong. And I got it from home. I got it from home. And it on my-